unstoppable, do the impossible. We the undeniable, royalty indefinable.
Ford knows that your vehicle is a reflection of you. So they design beautifully innovative, stylish cars like the Explorer, Escape, and Fusion to make your journey safer, smarter, and more dynamic. Ford, born to roll.
Roll on, sister, roll on.
Learn more at IamBornToRoll.com.
Blog Talk Radio.
Hello, hello, hello. It's another glorious day, my tea sippers, and you know what time it is. I hope you have all of your comforts together because it's time to dish the tea. And you're dishing darlings. With Big Munch.
That same old song.
Double Exposure Media Relations is a full-service public relations, marketing, and artist development firm specializing in urban culture and lifestyle. Spearheaded by the Henry Hingers of hip-hop, Mr. Angelo Ellerby, Double Exposure serves to educate its clients about the dollars and cents of the music industry. For more information about Double Exposure Media Relations, call 201-224-6510. 201-224-6510. Double Exposure Media Relations.
And hello, 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 hello. Out there in Blog Talk Radio land, here in the glorious United States and across the globe, for those of you who are over there in Germany and Italy and France and the Caribbean islands, and for all of you within the sound of my voice, honey, it's another glorious day, my tea sippers, and I hope you have all of your crumpets because you know what time it is, because, darlings, it's time to dish tea, and you're dishing tea, darlings, with Big Meech. What's going on, babies? Yes, 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 yes. I'm coming to you today with another commentary for you. Here we're still celebrating, you know, Black History Month and carrying on, or the history of Americans of African descent. And I wanted to chime in on another aspect of history that often gets overlooked. And it's time that we celebrate all of these things, because one of the things about our history and herstory is that it is very, I've said before, very rich and very diverse. And in order for this thing to be, it has to be all-inclusive. You know what I'm saying? We cannot negate those areas of the community that either we disagree with, we don't like, or whatever the case may be, because every aspect of the community has given us some richness and has added to the complete tapestry of our existence here on this side of the planet. So, and creation. So we have to be all inclusive. And one of the things that I want to give commentary on today for your consideration and for you to sit down and to really ponder or pontificate is to think about our trans community. Now, you know, the last few times that you've heard me speak, I've been talking about, you know, the transgender, or brought up the T in the LGBT community. And I want to focus on Black trans women or trans men. But in particular, I'm talking about trans women because usually they're the ones who are most visible within the community. For our trans brothers, I'm still learning a few of them and learning to get to know that side of the community. I am going to shout out one in particular who was my heart, and he was John Alexander Goodrum. And I shout his name and I call his name whenever I wish to talk Black trans issues, as he was a facilitator at one of my conferences for Detroit's Black Gay Pride. And I had the pleasure of meeting him and speaking with him and absolutely spending time with him. And he had taken his own life shortly after returning home from that particular event. So I celebrate him as I speak about trans empowerment and things. Today, I want to focus on the trailblazer and the pioneer of someone who, for a long period of time, honey, was doing her thing and has went on and, you know, had created a lot of and kicked open doors, whether she wanted to or not, she ended up doing it, okay? Because before there was Laverne Cox, before Janet Mock, and all the other girls that we know, and I'm going specifically with women of color, trans women of color, there was this one particular woman who many of you, if you're in my age, generation and things, you will remember her face from the Miss Clara box. You will remember her doing Essence magazines and carrying on. She did all kinds of layouts and things. She was a fashion model. She did a lot of print work back in the day, and oftentimes she goes unrecognized outside of the LGBT community because at the time she wasn't clocked or discovered, you know, until it until later on in her career. But I want to shout out and I want to celebrate the history of Ms. Tracy Gayle Morgan, otherwise known as Ms. Tracy Africa. Tracy was a trans woman, honey, who became, I like to say she was a supermodel, because I just went and listened to some footage of her, and her look became very, 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 very striking, because at one particular point in her career, they considered her to be, or thought she was, a younger version of Beverly Johnson. And so a lot of the work that she was able to get was due to that particular look, you know. And saying that, honey, y'all know Miss Beverly, honey, was everything and still is. And so is Miss Tracy, still is stunningly beautiful. And can still command her own. Tracy had went forth and, you know, got modeling contracts and things. And as she said in her interviews, that, you know, at that particular time that she got into it, you know, you were either fashion runway or you were print. You know, you, a lot of the girls at the time didn't do both. It was one or the other, and so she did a lot of print work and things, and so she became a face for so many, and she was just living her life, you know, and became, you know, just a presence within the fashion icon, within the fashion industry, and did, and for us as LGBT children, she became an icon for us, you know, over the years, and now that we're looking back over this career and looking at what she's accomplished and things, you know, we're able to hold our chest up, our heads up, and hold our, and stick our chests out, because for such a long time, you know, we've had someone who was on the forefront who was not living a life stereotypical of what the trans community is being held to. A lot of our trans sisters, you know, have to resort to a lot of illegal activities in order to make ends meet and to be, to, in order to survive. You know, oftentimes the rest of the world only sees our trans community as showgirls. You know, now that we have RuPaul's Drag Race and Carry It On, you know, and all of that, we see the drag queen, we see this, that, and the other. And a lot of that is for entertainment. But a lot of our trans sisters, I mean, those who want to move beyond that and come out of that particular way of living because they wish to live their lives as the gender that they are transitioning into, you know, oftentimes they're ostracized because a lot of people do not want to agree with the with their decision to transition, okay? Or, and a lot of folks, you know, they fear it. They don't understand it. For the religious community, of course, you know, want to throw shame and things and tell these folks that, you know, they have no business saying that God made a mistake and et cetera, et cetera. However, our transgender community happens to be, this has become a debatable point. A lot of folks don't want to accept this, but traditionally, scripture tells us that we had eunuchs. And a eunuch is someone who, there became many different definitions. And the definition that tradition liked to teach is that these particular folks were not born with any sexual genitalia, that they were sexually ambiguous, you know. However, our intersex people who were born with both fit that particular build. Those of us who have, you know, that are a part of the LGBT community and know our trans community, we know that their inner struggle is, you know, that everything about them on the inside doesn't match what their biology says on the outside. So oftentimes, you know, the religious community become up in arms because they don't want to accept the fact that these folks are our modern day eunuchs. And especially it becomes a little that way for me, because you want to say that everything that we're going through now, and this is what tradition teaches. I've had this said to me by many different pastors and preachers and deacons and all that, that we're living, you know, ain't nothing going on now that wasn't going on before, and blah, 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 blah. Well, if that's the case, then we have to take that argument across the board. And our trans community have become or are our eunuchs of today. And one of the things that says in traditional scripture is that some were born and then some became, some were made. Okay. And so that there is the part that a lot of folks do not want, wish to accept when it comes down to our trans community. And for those who are seeking to just be quote unquote normal, to have an everyday life, you know, to make a living, to earn an honest living, just to live and to just be themselves and to be free without any persecution or ridicule or threats of having their livelihood stopped or being forced out of town. You know, Tracy Africa was someone who showed the way that having a regular job, in fact, you know, we can even say she was, you know, somewhat Hollywood, if you will, because the fashion industry is a part of that whole Hollywood type of living. You know, with her having that kind of employment, she was able to have a different kind of lifestyle. She was able to travel. She did a lot of work over in Paris and things. She worked for Balenciaga, you know, the fabric, the fashion house of Balenciaga, and carrying on. She also was a face for Avon Cosmetics at one point, you know. So in that, she was also, like I said, working for Essence Magazine and things, and that was working very, very well for her until the day that we had someone who came and outed her to Susan Taylor. And according to the interview that she gave, this one particular gentleman, you know, was really more so just throwing shade practically, and was kind of like out to get her. And so he had exposed her to, or, you know, just exposed her to Susan Taylor, the editor-in-chief of Essence Magazine at the time. And, you know, that there became the end of her modeling career. Because she, you know, a lot of folks didn't want to work with her and carry on, and it was such a demise. It is my goal to be able to bring Miss Tracy onto the show so that we can get in her own words here with us, you know, the aftermath of what happened after that. She did say in an interview that, you know, she and a girlfriend of hers took what little bit of money they had left. They went over to Paris, and they were able to find work over in Paris and things, but it was difficult. Coming back to the States, she then got back into the ball scene, and now, you know, with her iconic status of being a transgender supermodel, she is known now as being the mother of the house of Africa, and it's a ball walking house, you know, and they compete for trophies and things, and she has become a mentor to a lot of trans children who are looking to follow in her footsteps, or at least to forge their own and make their own path here in mainstream society. One of the things I would like to say is that for those of us who do not know how to deal with our trans community, one of the things I will say, you know, is that we have to educate ourselves on the language that we present themselves, that we use, and when we're speaking with them, and then pay attention to how they present themselves. How they present themselves and how they represent themselves are two different things, okay? Presenting themselves is just the image that you see, honey. If you see someone who presents themselves as a woman, why would you sit down there and call them anything else other than? I know, I'm going to go here with Caitlin, because I know a lot of us know Caitlin as her former self, and it's very disrespectful when we sit down there and just call her Bruce. You know, it's very disrespectful because that's not what she's presenting anymore. And so you may not agree with it, but one of the things that we all do is that you don't want anyone to call you out of your name, okay? Especially when you have those coming-of-age names and carrying on. Or how about when you had a nickname and you've outgrown that nickname, Miss Poo-Poo or Pookie or whatever, and you wish to be called by your name, okay? And that you still find someone who wants to take you back to those particular days. It's disrespectful, isn't it? So if you feel that way, remember our trans community feels the exact same way. And that's why they become a lot of them are very defensive. A lot of them, you know, become very volatile in some cases because you refuse to acknowledge them for who they are. Also, in learning how they present themselves, how they represent themselves, now that there is where it becomes into question, because we have a lot of children out there who may not know how to be ladies and, you know, may come across as wretched children, you know, and things of that nature. So how they carry themselves and how they present themselves is, you know, a lot of what gets a lot of brings about a lot of scrutiny and a lot of the ridicule that our trans sisters receive. Our trans brothers are a little bit more stealth in the community when it comes down to transitioning. One of the things that, you know, becomes a problem, it's a hindrance. Because a lot of our trans women, and our trans women are our male to female, those transitioning from male to female, oftentimes because of body image, you know, we have those who, you know, they may take a little bit more after their fathers, you know, and their feminization process may not have been, you know, or still may not have been up to par or still needs perfecting. You know, there's just certain things that body-wise they may not be able to cover or whatever. And so because of that, you know, a lot of people wish to, you know, get derogatory with them and all of that, and that's unfair. You know, that there was unfair and it's insensitive. With our trans men, most of them slide through a little bit easier because once the facial hair comes into play, basically – trans men may look like pretty men, you know, very, very attractive men or whatever, but because they have facial hair and their voice starts to drop a little bit, we accept them as men. Oftentimes, trans men are seen as gay men, you know, because of that, but they are seen as men. Our trans women, on the other hand, because you're able to see obvious signs that they may have been biologically male or whatever, everybody wants to point it out, pick it out, this, that, and the other, and that there is uncalled for. So what we have to do is educate ourselves on the rich history of what this is. At this point, I also want to take a little time and shout out a couple of names because when we talk about sexual reassignment surgery in the trans community, oftentimes a lot of folks think that it's supposed to mean that everyone is looking to have the surgery, you know, sexual reassignment surgeries and stuff, and they're looking to just do other things to their bodies and alter and carry on, and that may not necessarily be the case. But one of the things about the history of our Black trans movement is that we also were looking to find, you know, who was the first Black trans person to receive sexual reassignment surgeries and carrying on. And there's been a big debate about that because there's been a couple of names that's been tossed around. And I want to give them, you know, just a shout out because these are names that nobody knows. One of them happens to be Delisa. She was from New Orleans. There's very little information about her, but she is in the running as one of the top two people who may have been the first to have sexual reassignment surgery. The other person, her name is Phyllis Wilson. She was a dancer performing under the name of Avon, or Avon, however you wish to pronounce it, Wilson. And a little bit of information about her was that she was the first person to go through the sexual reassignment surgery at the Johns Hopkins Gender Studies Center. And she went on and had gotten married. And that there is all the information that we know about her at this particular time. If either one of these women are still alive, honey, if we can find them, hopefully they are, and they'll be willing to come forth and to share their stories and to share how they were able to forge a life and make a life for themselves and, you know, what it meant to be post-operative in this particular world, particularly at a time, because you're talking about when they did this, this was in the 60s. This articles and stuff that were found come from 1967, you know, when this was done and all of that. And this is very, very brand new at this particular time. And I'm highlighting these girls because, again, I'm highlighting those who are of African American descent or Americans of African descent, as I'm trying to learn to say. We do know about Christine Jorgensen, who is being documented as the very first person to ever undergo it, period, although that's in debate as well. However, we do want to educate ourselves on this community and then learn a little bit more about it so that it doesn't frighten you, it doesn't scare you, it doesn't put you at arms with them, or at least it can reduce all of the naysaying and carrying on, because we don't understand why we are who we are. And the whole idea of transitioning, you know, is something that many of us don't understand. A lot of us probably don't agree with it. And I know in the African-American community or the Americans of African descent community, black folks, you know, we tend to shun those who wish to come away from or what we feel is someone who is throwing away their masculinity or not being a quote-unquote man about it or whatever. We tend to shun them and things and not understanding what their struggle is. So we really have to get into understanding and educating ourselves about this community. Whether you agree with it or not is something different. But if you get the tools that you need to understand the community a little bit better, you're able to press forward. I'm very thankful that before I moved here to Atlanta, we were able to take a transgender 101 course to the Detroit Police Department. It was called the 7th Precinct at the time, but now they're under districts, right there at Woodward and 7 Mile. And we were able to educate those officers on the community, because that they were the ones who practically dealt with the girls who were out there working the stroll and carrying on. And I'm very proud of that. And I would like to offer that to you, to where you get into some information so that you can educate yourself about this community. So, yeah. So we're winding down, and I just wanted to shout out Tracy Africa as a pioneer and a trailblazer for our trans community, honey, who went and broke down those doors, honey, for a lot of the girls. And now, because of her, we can have transgender models and we can have trans men models and, you know, who are not afraid to sit down there and be who they are and can still be fabulous and fierce and lovely and all of those kinds of things without the persecution and the ridicule. So in this Black History celebration, Tracy Africa, Tracy Gayle Norman, a.k.a. Morgan, Tracy Africa, we salute you, my sister, and thank you for all of your work. So if anybody else, if you have any questions, comments, or concerns, please feel free to email me, bigmeach@dishingtea.com, or follow me on the Facebook pages, my Facebook page or the Dishing Tea page, YouTube, and on Twitter. So with that, my darlings, I will bid you all a farewell for now, and we will talk again very soon. Ciao.